Hello and welcome everyone to an interview that I've been looking forward to now for a few weeks. Now this is a tough subject. This is probably one of the most, it is the most ridiculed conspiracy of them all. And so as someone who has been called and considered themselves a conspiracy theorist for a long time, I didn't even know this was a conspiracy. I did not even realize that the concept, the idea that we live on a globe was considered a conspiracy. I didn't know that the Flat Earth Society was an actual society. I thought it was a derogatory term that you threw out to people who you considered had outdated thinking. Now this came into my awareness about 2 months ago, maybe less, 6 weeks. And it was presented to me by a friend on Facebook who sent me a video and said, am I out of my mind or is there something to this? And I watched the video that they linked me to and I had to respond with, if you're out of your mind, so am I. Now, if you've never questioned NASA, its validity, if you've never questioned the space agencies in general, if you've never questioned the Apollo missions, if you've never questioned the moon landings, then this may well be one of the biggest leaps we're asking you to make over the next couple of hours by considering the information. I have. I came to the conclusion a long time ago that the moon landings were not legit. I don't believe that the Apollo missions were as presented. So this wasn't such a leap for me to question the space agencies and what they've put out there for us. But so I'm just going to ask you to suspend your disbelief for the next couple of hours as we look at the information, we ask the questions, and the implications, the reason why this, in my opinion, is the most ridiculed is simply because of the implications and the audacity involved. The sheer audacity to attempt to hide the very ground we walk on, our environment, and our relationship to ourselves and our creators, creator, God, whatever that is, because it's all involved. The implications of that big. And I think it's just, you know, it's just too big. But we're going to do our best today. So I'd like to welcome my guest, Mark Sargent. Welcome, Mark.
Hi, Lisa. Thanks for having me.
I'm really excited. Like I said, if this is true, this is the mother of all conspiracies.
Indeed.
Indeed. How do you hide the world?
How do you hide the world? Do you want me to?
I'd firstly like to ask you why you even started questioning this. How did this come into your awareness?
This came out into my awareness out of sheer boredom.
Okay.
Let's be honest here. Like a lot of conspiracy people, you know, if you've done it for a long enough time, you've looked at stuff and you've gone through the gamut of all the conspiracy. We won't go necessarily into them now, but there was one conspiracy that absolutely for the conspiracy crowd is radioactive. Nobody touches it. It's ridiculous. It's laughable. It's ludicrous. And even I wouldn't look at it. You know, I would go through old stuff 10 times over before I would look at it. And it was known as the Flat Earth Theory. And so, it sort of bugged me that I wouldn't look at it because it was like a folder on your desk and it was almost embarrassing to touch. So I set out to prove this, the globe. I said, okay, I should be able to knock it out in 2 or 3 days. Piece of cake. Because it's easy and you know, it's what you and I, you know, grew up with. It's what we know, which is what I'll get into in a second. And, I stared at this thing. I tried to prove this model for about 9 months. And after that 9 months, I realized that every time, every layer I went deeper in, it just got flatter and flatter, to the point where then I was questioning, how did we come to this? You know, then I was questioning, okay, when did it become a globe? You know, I started to really wonder how we got to this point. And it started, you know, it starts at a young age. And here's where people don't, you know, they don't understand. Because I've asked people, I say, how do you know this is where you live right now? Right. And the first reaction is almost always the same. It's like, well, we know. That's just, you know, that's what we know. And what I mean is they equate it with things that are absolutely given. Water is wet. Fire burns. That's gravity. Right. And it's like, okay, but they're equating this shape, which is really just an image, with those other things, you know, givens, you know, you can test, that's the thing. You can test water, you can test fire, you can test gravity all day long. We all know those things to be true. But this is one of those things where, you know, it's like, how do you know for sure? And then the second question comes in, which is, well, or the second response from them, which is, well, you know, they've got the picture. NASA told us. And, you know, then the riddle comes out. And I'm not going to take credit for it. And it's like, okay, how do you know this is what we, you know, where you live without using the word NASA? And that's where it stumps them. And, you know, that was the beginning for me, was, okay, now I've got to come at it from the other direction. Now it's not a question of if it's flat, it's how, you know, how was the globe created? How, you know, how was the real world hidden? How do you hide the world?
Well, when I started looking into this, what I looked at was all the ancient cultures and religions.
Yeah.
And they almost all, for the most part, have an identical image and terminology.
Yep.
A lot of the old ancient cultures, including the Australian Aboriginal, which was not easy to find, talks about, they make references to an egg of some sort. You know, it's a contained environment, which is where the dome sort of conversation comes in. But that it's flat was universal.
Yeah.
That through religion and culture all the way back. So when did it go from being this flat plane to being a globe?
Perfect point. And for those, again, those people out there that don't know their history, and you really should know your history, is for the first 4,500 years, you know, if our records, you know, go fairly seamlessly, go back, say, 5,000 years, the first 4,500 years, all the cultures and religions pretty much agreed on the same sort of thing. It was a flattish, I say flattish, not perfectly flat, and we'll get into that as we go on, flattish circular area that was enclosed one way or the other, you know, with either a permanent barrier or a semi-permanent barrier, that everything, you know, was easy to manage, and that's where it was. And then during, you know, one of the scientific revolutions in the 1500s, it was proposed, you know, by, you know, Copernicus and others, okay, that, you know, using some very, you know, leap of faith math, you know, projections, you know, saying, yeah, if this is spinning at 1,000 miles an hour and going through space at 60,000 miles an hour, then yeah, you can, you know, you can build a solar system, and that's, you know, what our world looks like. And that stuck because, you know, why not? You know, it's like anything.
But wasn't it eventually a church
the church had to jump on board.
Church of England or something.
Yeah, yeah. Once
later ones took it on.
Yeah, yeah. And I don't know exactly who were the first ones to jump on board. But once they jumped on board and people, because actually, you know, from an image point of view, this is pretty cool. No question. It's a lot cooler than a disc. You can, you know, it's spherical. People completely identify it. You know, with the whole, you know, spherical thing, you know, it's children's toy, you know, it's the shape of fruit. It's real easy to do. But the church adapted as quickly as they could because there, you know, then you've got a problem, because you can't have the church saying that it's a flattish thing with a firmament and have science saying that it's a globe. You can't have the two, you know, because, you know, at that point, the church may start losing followers. So the church saying, okay, well, you know, they can interpret, you know, their religious text a certain way, and they'll sort of kind of bend into the globe model. And that worked. And so everyone was on board with it. Everybody was happy. There was a problem, though, and that was you couldn't prove it. And by that, I mean, they were centuries away from proving it. It's not like nowadays, you know, where you can prove all sorts of stuff and you may have to wait a little while. They were, you know, this was 1500, you know, the first balloons, you know, that could carry people weren't for another 200 years. The planes weren't for, you know, another 400 years. Honestly, it wasn't until the last 60 years ago that the rocket program was able to go up high enough to take a picture of this. But if they did take a picture of this, they didn't release it. In fact, they didn't release any pictures until, you know, and depending on who you look at, and we'll look at the picture a little bit later, until either, you know, 1968 to 1972, and they only released one picture. So, you know, then it was part of the mystery, but I don't, you know, I might be getting out of my timeline here. So what direction do you want to take?
Well, I like the fact that you set out to prove the globe.
Yeah.
And it just isn't doable from the standpoint that you approached it from. And what I want to let people know is that Mark caught my attention because he put up a series of videos on YouTube called The Flat Earth Clues, 1 to 10.
Yeah.
It's just been put up.
Yep.
And we're going to sort of step through those clues, giving a synopsis of what each of those videos mean.
Okay.
And I suggest everyone go back and have a look at them for more information on each of those clues. So you approach this from if I was going to create this planet and I was going to do it as a flat Earth model, just purely from a design standpoint, how would I create it? And how would I create it in such a way as that the people would never discover that that's the way it looks?
Yeah. And what I initially did, because I came from a computer game design background, I initially went in saying, okay, I still don't buy it. I'm still not on board completely, but I will try to create the design of the flat model, the enclosed world. And if I get to any point in that where something just does not jibe, I'm just going to abandon the whole thing and say it's crap and people, you know, shouldn't listen to this ever again. And as I was working through it, the design just got better and better to the point where everything that you can think of that is done in a globe model is actually easier in a flat model, way easier to do. And from the oceans to the continent layout, to the temperature levels on the borders, to the temperature and oxygen levels in the top, you know, that brilliant design feature they put in, you add 3% salt solution to the oceans and you reduce, you know, ocean discoveries by 95%. It's like the whole thing was designed to keep us, you know, we'll look at the video stuff in a second, but keep us in some sort of a natural state, like it was part of an education system combined with some entertainment. People said, well, you know, isn't it, you know, aren't you really kind of building a jail? And I go, no, not at all. Because if it's a jail, it's a very beautiful and very comfortable jail. And there's no bars in the windows. So people don't even know that they're in an enclosed system, which is, you know, which made it even more amazing. But yeah, as I built more and more layers onto this, I got to the point where I realized, okay, now we're talking about a flat model. But if it's flat model, how do you hide it from everyone? And that's the tricky part. Do you want me to get into that now, or do you want me to talk about the clue stuff? Or
I do want you to talk about the clue stuff, but you just brought something up, which is, and I don't know whether you've got an opinion on this or whether your research has led you to think one way or the other, but
sure.
The question for me is, so we've got the whole planet believing that the world is flat.
Yep.
Copernicus and his cronies.
Yeah.
Decide that it's a globe.
Yep.
I'm trying to figure out still at this point whether that was a deliberate deception back then.
Yes. Yes, it is. I'm sorry. Go ahead.
Sorry. And that what happened when – oh, hang, sorry. How do I put this? So it's a deliberate deception back then.
Yep.
For whatever reason, which we can get into. And they get to a point where eventually they have to prove this fraudulent concept. Or Copernicus was genuine in his belief. It was adopted because it was convenient. And it's not until NASA comes along in the 60s and start sending anything up there far enough for them to realize, or even Bird earlier, that they go, oh, shit, hang on. It is actually flat. And at that point, decide to maintain the status quo. So I'm still in two minds about which way this may have played out.
From my point of view, there is little doubt in my mind that the globe model was introduced by whoever built this enclosed system artificially sometime back in the 1500s. And I know that sounds wild, but I don't believe the Copernicus, who, by the way, didn't even publish this until the day, you know, made sure it was like in his will, like the day after he died, which is also interesting. But I think it was introduced hundreds of years ago as a natural process to slow down. So people, you know, because technology, they, you know, eventually was going to get to the point where people were going to find the edge. But even then, I think it was kept secret. So, but it was one of those things. So for people out there that aren't quite getting this yet, imagine a conspiracy so big that even the power elite, even the authority, don't know for sure because they have no way to figure it out. So let's say, just pick a couple off the top of my head, the Illuminati or the Masonic, or, you know, pick any old group, you know. Let's say they get a map that shows them, you know, the what the world really looks like. Well, who does that benefit, you know, in the 1500s or the 1600s? Nobody, because, you know, you've got wooden ships. Your explorers aren't going to be doing much. There's no internal combustion engine. And so they just sit on it, but it's still in the back of their heads, right? So we go forward to the 1920s, you know, after the internal combustion engine is made, and you start sending out explorers, the most notable being Admiral Byrd from the United States, who does the North Pole in 1926. And then he is recruited and sent down to the South Pole, what we call the South Pole, in 1928. And from 1928 until 1954, he does four series of expeditions. And there's little doubt in my mind that that's what they were looking for. Sort of like an Indiana Jones thing. It's really cool in that sense, where he's just going down there and he just keeps exploring, because Antarctica is so vast, you know, millions of square miles, that he just keeps exploring and keeps exploring. And I don't even know if they told him, you know, what, because, you know, the interview, which we'll get into in a second, I don't even know if he knew for sure. He was definitely on point. You know, they were, you know, he's totally funded. And, you know, he was also a Mason, not that really has anything to do with it, but I don't think they let him in on it. So at the end of 1954, he comes back and does that television interview in the States for CBS, where, and I think at that point they had almost given up. Meaning, you know, again, this thing's so big that the power elite were going, well, we already sent him four times and he hasn't come back with anything. So maybe there's nothing there. Maybe this map, this ancient map that we got, is wrong. And, you know, because he's talking about the resources and how they're going to do expeditions every year and all these countries are down there and everything's great. And then that's Murphy's Law for you. You know, they make all these plans. It's like, well, at least we'll make a lot of money off of it. And then in 1956, that all changed. 1956, this world changed, and most people have no idea how nutty it got after 1956. You know, we were distracted with all sorts of things, you know, Roswell and all sorts of, you know, other conspiracies. But this one was the one that really, the moves that were made were so broad and so decisive that every time I looked at it, I just cringed. I was going, oh my, the things they were doing were so absolute. They didn't take chances on anything. You know, it wasn't like, you know, they made no mistakes, in my opinion. Well, maybe one sort of mistake, but everything that was done to hide this was done with massive broad strokes. And
all right, well, let's step everyone through the clues.
Through the clues. Okay, so
you'll get to that and be able to build on it.
Yeah. So So by the way, people, if you're on YouTube, it's Flat Earth Clues, but at this point it's getting so much traction, you don't even have to, you could Google Flat Earth Clues and it'll come up. Apparently I coined that. I have no idea how that happened. Cause I would have thought after the 9/11 September clues, people would have jumped all over, you know, different clue stuff, but that's fine. Hey, great. Wonderful. I'm not trademarking it. So if anyone wants to steal it, go ahead. So I initially started out by just making a guide. That's all I wanted to make, was one thing. which was called the Flat Earth Guide, or the Guide to the Flat Earth, depending on which way you look at it. And, you know, ran like 15 minutes, and it was kind of, you know, just an overview of things. And then the night after I released it, I realized, I was going, oh, there's these little nagging things I got to talk about. And the more I started looking into it, the more, you know, the more clues I was doing, the further along I was going. They were building on each other, to the point where when I got, you know, number eight, I was going, oh, you know, I got to the point where it's like, yeah, I'm going to preach this, you know, label me whatever you want. Label me, you know, a tin hat crazy person. But if I sound like a crazy person, no one's called me on it yet. Nobody's emailed me and said, you sound crazy. Because again, I was supposed to debunk this. This is not supposed to be what the world, you know, I'm not supposed to be preaching what the world looks like, but that's where I am. So the first clue I did was empty theater. And the short version of that was, and you know, do you want me to go up, just go down and talk about each clue and kind of branch off? Or do you want me to just go boom, 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 boom?
Whatever you feel.
Okay.
At this point, whatever you feel.
So empty theater covered a little thing that most people don't know. In fact, nobody knows. In fact, I'm the first YouTube person to do it. I have no idea why it was missed, which was why one of those little things. Because people can talk about the moon missions and NASA and make fun all they want. But what I thought was very interesting was, especially, you know, in the States where we make tons and tons of movies that are just crappy and horrible, is that the greatest achievement in human civilization, supposedly, nobody's ever made a movie about, and that would be the moon landings. And it's staggering to me. And as I was doing research on it, I realized that there seems to be, you know, it was part of the deliberate thing to just keep people from even thinking, even questioning, that take the, you know, the globe out of their head for whatever reason. People don't understand, you know, 60, or 50 something years later, you know, after the space program, you know, reached its pinnacle, nobody ever made a movie about it. The closest thing ever was the Right Stuff in 1983, which really was just an astronaut recruiting movie more than anything. And that was made 12 years after the last Apollo mission. And then no other movie was made until 1995, I believe. That was 12 years after that with Apollo 13. And that was it. Nobody ever made a movie off of it. And
so there's never been a major Hollywood film
that
details the actual landing and has scenes of the astronauts on the moon.
No, and it's staggering to me, because people, especially in the entertainment industry, they know full well the crap, you know, the remakes
we've made movies with them landing on asteroids and comets.
Oh yeah.
And distant planets and. But yeah, that's kind of, yeah, you have to ask the question, why not?
Yeah, and that reinforces it. And the people, you know, like The Right Stuff, for example, that was set up for a sequel. It was pushing 3.5 hours in the 1980s, which is just obscenely long in the 1980s for a movie. And it ended with, you know, the first Earth orbit. And so people are going, oh, well, there's a sequel, you know, coming. It made money. It won Academy Awards. It's not like it was a rinky-dink production, big name cast. And the sequel never got made. No one talks about it, you know, or, you know, and the reason is, and you'll see it if you get into the clue, you know, I'm not doing it necessarily justice here. The reason is because if the movie is too spot on, if the production is too close to the original, then you're going to have that weird, funny feeling, you know, it's like, okay, what am I looking at exactly? Plus, you know, you're exposing Hollywood to that, you know, production people are going, oh yeah, you know how it would go with the backstage. It's like, oh geez, you know, this is probably what they did to, you know, do the moon landings, and then you just can't let them touch it. So for whatever reason, you know, no movie's ever been done, you know, to recreate the moon missions. Even now, even
did you watch the Jay Widener series, Kubrick's Odyssey?
I did, and I also mentioned the one I liked, Room 237. Which was, you know, the brilliant thing for those people out there. And I won't go into it in great detail here, but Moon 237, a fantastic documentary about the Stanley Kubrick question, you know, which was, I don't think it's rumor at all, which was, if he was hired by the Department of Defense in 1963, given an unlimited budget, and said, look, show us what we can do to simulate the space program on film. He milked that thing for 5 years, and it soured him greatly at the end. And, you know, at the end, he released 2001, A Space Odyssey, probably the finest space simulation in the history of cinema, even now, even though it's, you know, decades old. But he was so upset by it that, yeah, the rumor is, and again, I don't think it's a rumor, is that he, when he did the 1980 movie, The Shining, he built in the confession of him working on the space program into the movie The Shining. And you can see it, you know, watch the documentary. Kubrick was, in my opinion, the greatest director of all time. And it was just a genius at setting things up. And he put little hidden clues, because he couldn't talk to any about it.
But, you know, even if Kubrick didn't do it, I think what Jay was able to show is the technology was there.
Absolutely.
In the 60s to pull that off.
Yeah. Yeah. No question. No question. Anyway, let's jump to the other clues. Just we'll come back to what happened down in Antarctica in a second. So number two is the bird wall. And that one really, I'll get in a little deeper into that one, because that one for me was my point of no return, which was when I was looking at it, by the time I finished the bird wall, the clue number two, I was hooked. There was no turning back for me. It was over. And that was what happened in Antarctica. And people just, again, it's one of those hidden things that people don't know. You know, I've talked, you know, I could talk to 1,000 people on the street and none of them know this, which was when they were looking for the enclosure, the edge, or you want to call it the firmament, you know, whatever religious text you want to use. When they were looking for it, it appeared that they found it in 1956, because in 1954, they were going to make a whole bunch of money. And I know it's an old gag from my other interviews, but I'm going to say show it to you anyway. And that is, it's the old comedy routine, which is, you know, where the hero, they go one direction and then they change the other direction. So one day it is, we are going to be in Antarctica for the next 100 years and make a ton of money. Then they see it, we are out of here. And they all left, you know, all the nations left at the same time. United States, Russia, Great Britain, Chile, Australia, New Zealand, you know, everybody, they all left at the same time. And what happened after that was immediately Russia and the United States, who happened to be both down there at the same time, started up their rocket program immediately after that.
And a treaty.
Well, that came as they were doing the rocket program, because think about it this way. If you found the outer edge, okay, now you got to figure out, okay, what's the upper enclosure like? But you don't have a rocket program to test it. And the only, you know, the only rocket programs was the old Nazi programs, you know, the V-2s. So the Russia and America, they start doing their rocket programs in 1952. And then for whatever reason, they decide they're going to put nuclear weapons on the top of these things in 1958. And they just start firing them straight up. And I'm not going to get into the nuclear weapon debate right now. We'll just assume that nuclear weapons are real and everything's cool. And they start firing rockets up in 1958. And, you know, and the third or fourth shots were big, big hits, you know, 3.8 megaton, that type stuff.
You know what altitude they got?
I'm sorry, what?
Altitude.
Oh, it varies. It depends. That's all listed in Wikipedia, but I don't know if you can trust the altitudes. I mean, some said, you know, someone went up 40 kilometers, some went up 100 kilometers, 200 kilometers. Oh, and, you know, let's not forget that one of the package, the series of tests was done, was called Operation Fishbowl. Which I was like, oh, really? That's what
really?
You're out there? That's the most creative name you could come up with? It's you're not even going to hide that? So,
do you know off the top of your head how many nuclear bombs they set off up there?
Officially, yeah, I can tell you in 1 second here. If anyone wants to look this up, and I'm not going to share my screen just to show you, you just look up high altitude nuclear explosion.
So just going over the timeline again.
Yeah,
you've got Bird going down there over how many years? Did
1928 to years? Yeah, so 1928 to 1956, he went down there. A total of I think 5 expeditions, at least 4. I'm pretty sure 5. And on the 5th one, he finds something.
And you've got all these countries down there at the time.
At least
crossing at the mouth.
Yeah, because there are the resources that are down there are infinite. You know, in fact, Bird on national television, again, watch this. The guy's not, you know, he's the most credible man in America at the time. You know, he's the youngest admiral ever. He's a fleet commander. He's doing all this stuff. And he goes, oh, yeah, there's an entire mountain range made out of coal that could supply the entire world with coal. There's oil, there's minerals, there's uranium, there's all this stuff. And there's a whole section. That's just the stuff they found. And of course, that's the foreshadowing. It's like, oh yeah, there's a whole nother section of land bigger than the United States we haven't even flown over yet. You know, no one's even I haven't seen it. You know, he's, you know, because he's the explorer. So right after that, he goes down there, and so in 1956, they find it, right? What I consider to be, you know, the edge or the barrier or a marker or whatever it is. But for whatever reason, they decided they wanted to fire nuclear weapons straight up starting in 1958. The rocket program started in 1957. So in 1958, they start firing nuclear weapons, and I'm looking at the shots. The shots started April 1958. With Operation Hardtack, the United States fall with Operation Argus.
Did you say Heart Attack?
No, Hardtack. I think that's a cowboy food thing. I'm probably butchering it, but it doesn't really matter. Operation Argus, the United USSR did their tests starting in 1961. Operation Fishbowl started in 1962. And there were several failures, I think, in 1962.
Do you know what the official reason given was?
Do you need a reason to, you know, you can make up whatever reason you want, you know, and, you know, back then it's like, well, we're just doing nuclear testing because nuclear weapons were so new. But here's what gets interesting. So 1958, they're firing up weapons and they keep firing. But right after that first, So it's this chain of events, and you're going, you know, what's the old saying? I love it so much. I believe in coincidences, but I've never seen one. That's what happens here, which is right after that first or second shot with I think it was like the 3.8 megaton shot that they did in August, they form NASA right afterwards. So you find the outer edge, you fire your biggest gun you have straight up. That's not working. All right, we got to control the skies. We form NASA, right? 9 months after they form NASA, they seal off Antarctica permanently. And that's the staggering thing that most people don't understand. It's like people don't understand. You can take a vacation to that little peninsula on the outer part of Antarctica, but everything else is completely sealed off. The treaty was created, and anyone can look it up, in 1959. 10 nations signed it. And they basically banned any country from doing anything on Antarctica ever. And this isn't like an Area 51 thing where you're sealing off part of Nevada, you know, with fences and guard dogs and that sort of stuff and scary signs that saying, don't come in here. They sealed off the entire continent. That's the equivalent of shutting off the Americas after Panama Canal, you know, just putting a gate there and saying, oh yeah, nobody goes to South America for the rest of history. You know, and that's what they did. They sealed off Antarctica permanently. And every nation, once they became technologically viable, you know, as an economic power, they were forced to sign it. How does that work? You know, oh, hey, we just became a country, you know, a technologically tradable country. Oh, yeah, by the way, sign this document. You don't get to go down to Antarctica. For how long? Well, forever. You don't get to go down there. So that was 1959. And they kept firing, you know, meanwhile, they keep firing up the rockets, but they're not sending up the big stuff anymore. Because I think once you realize that megaton isn't going to cut it, you know, well, you know, at that point, you just have to probe. What I think they were doing was, I think they were probing the arc, you know, the dimensions of it, because at that point, they had to figure out the space, you know, because it would benefit them for the space program. Meaning, you need to know the limits of what you could do in simulating a space program. So the United States and Russia both stopped firing nukes at the exact same day. And people say, oh, it was a moratorium over aerial testing. It's like, that's a bunch of crap. No, they called each other. We've never been enemies. The Cold War is an absolute sham. They were both in on it the entire time. They were, you know, because they were both on the ice at the same time. They were there when we were there. They knew it. You know, do you think Russia would have voluntarily left? You know, they were trying to rebuild after World War II. So was Great Britain.
There's two obvious discussions that we're not having.
Yeah.
Right. And okay, we won't end up going into them today because they're a whole other tangent.
Okay.
But we might do on another occasion.
Okay.
One would be, because you can't talk about Admiral Byrd without mentioning Hollow Earth.
Oh, yeah, because he's the legend of Hollow Earth. Yeah.
The legend of Hollow Earth.
Yeah.
And that is another discussion.
Yeah, it is. And unfortunately, it is. It's another discussion. But it does not conflict with this model at all.
No, just, I realize that now.
Yeah.
I did initially think it did. And the other one is the German Nazi presence.
Yeah, there's that. But I talked about this in another interview, but I'll give you the 30-second breakdown of that. And that is, yeah, there's Operation Hardtack, which was the, oh, Lord, I think it was definitely the one right after World War II in 1946, where Admiral Byrd was the fleet commander, and he led an entire carrier group, 13 ships down there, 5,000 men, and to do something. Now, the rumor is that the Germans were also looking for it. Again, it's got that great Indiana Jones feel. Somebody in Hollywood, make a movie out of this. I know you won't be able to, but at least get the script going, because the Germans would have been looking for the edge too. And they, you know, the Germans, how technologically, you know, up they were at the time. It's like, sure. Well, you know, while we're in World War II, because during World War II, we weren't down there. The expeditions weren't going down there. But the rumor was that the Germans were. So if they would have found something eventually, or, you know, maybe they kept it a secret. Maybe they were just looking. Maybe they didn't find it either. But the Americans wanted to root them out. So the story goes that in 1946, even though Germany officially surrendered, you know, a year earlier, they went down there to take care of it. And for me, it was like, I didn't dwell on it too much, because whatever they did down there in 1946, it was done. It was taken care of, because, you know, Byrd, again, fleet commander, 1954 on television, he was perfectly fine. Didn't seem nervous at all. You know, nobody ever, you know, the Nazi story wasn't even an issue back then. So, you know, whatever they took care of, they took care of. And then they just started up their expeditions again after that. So anyway, sorry, didn't mean to go on a rant.
No, that's okay. But they are two conversations that I think are worth going into just at a later date.
Yeah. And we're not
ignoring them on purpose. We're just trying to.
And I put that in one of the videos. I was going, look, in fact, I was lucky, because when I started down this path, I knew about Admiral Byrd and the Hollow Earth theory. And I was going, you know, I was reading his bio and I was going, yeah, Hollow Earth, blah, blah, blah. And then I all of a sudden realized, it's like, well, he changed direction, and he was pretty much ordered to, you know, it's like, focus all your energies on the South Pole. And that's where he spent from 1928 till his death in 1957. That's where he spent all his time. So anyway, but that's a whole other thing. So,
okay.
Where was I? So anyway, all the funny stuff started happening in 1959, and by 1962, the nuke stuff had stopped, and then the space program started up. And then again, if you believe in coincidences, that's when the whole moon programs, you know, 1963. Oh, yeah, by the way, that's when Stanley Kubrick started making 2001 A Space Odyssey, which is an interesting story in itself. And then the whole reason for that was, and again, this is for people out there that just don't, you know, they're not quite getting it yet. And that was, here's the problem. Eventually, but you have to control the skies. If you're trying to hide it, one of the first things you got to do is you have to militarize the space program. And I mean worldwide. And so Russia and America, again, never enemies. They are not enemies. They've never been at, not at the highest levels. At the highest levels, they have been friends. And I don't want to get into it too much here, but they were, you know, their space program was being faked at the same time ours was. And they gave up later, you know, or they toned it down because they realized we were better at, well, because we had guys like Stanley Kubrick. We figured out a way to pretend. But the point was, sooner or later, despite 20 generations of a globe being handed out in classrooms, you know, 500 years worth of globes, eventually someone had to produce a picture. And I say produce rather than take, because if it's flat, you can't take a picture of this. So how do you fake it? Unfortunately, you can't just, now we had the artistry, we had the ability to produce a picture, and maybe I should share one for you. Want me to try this with the share screen?
No.
Okay. So if I say share screen.
Right. It isn't, I mean, and it is a fact.
Yeah.
You know, we've had a space program now since the 60s.
Yeah.
And there is one photograph.
Yeah. And are you seeing my screen?
Yes, I am.
Okay. This is the photograph right here. This photograph Back in 2000, when I was actually looking for photographs of the Earth from space, this is the only photograph that that NASA has officially released of the Earth from space. And you can always tell it's this photograph that because it's got that neat little crescent cloud thing here. But this photograph also killed two birds with one stone. You would have thought that if America was doing the space program, they would have taken a picture of the North American continent. But what they did was they took a picture of the bottom part of Africa and then what they claimed to be Antarctica and a whole lot of cloud cover. Don't think for a second that that's accidental. They want to be, you know, want this to be as obscured as possible. But this was the only picture that was in any textbook, that was in any classroom. And then when the internet fired up, it was the only picture online. Well, like when 2000, when I was looking for these pictures, literally it was just rows and rows and rows of this image. And you got to ask yourself, why would there only be one image from space? You know, 2000, we had plenty of cameras and supposedly, you know, all sorts of stuff up there, but nobody was taking a picture of the Earth. Should I get out of this?
Now, while you're looking at it, while it's up.
Okay, go ahead.
The background, the blackness of space.
Oh, yeah.
This is something that, without even realizing that I was questioning it for the reasons that I am now.
Yeah.
The model that I've always seen, this enormous sun, miles away from us.
Many 92 million miles, if you believe the story.
92 million miles.
Yeah.
That hits our tiny little planet.
Yep.
Bathing it in light.
Yep.
That means that light is traveling out in all directions. Why is space black? The blackness of space. That was just one of those things. I don't get it. Like, why isn't space all lit up with sunlight?
Good point. Excellent.
What is the argument for that? What's the scientific reason for that? Did they say something about it? It doesn't actually emit light. It's only when it hits our atmosphere or something.
It depends what you're looking at. The easiest thing, like for example, like this picture here, there's no stars in the background.
Well, yeah, that either.
Yeah. The biggest problem they had, and you know, I don't want to throw in the moon stuff too much because I didn't touch about it in the videos, but the big problem is math. And that is, if you're simulating this, if you're simulating that Earth, that's not so hard. The hard part is the constellations in the background. Because if you show the constellations in the background, and this image is date-stamped or time-stamped, you're going to have to be real accurate on where the, you know, nowadays it's easy. But, you know, so they did anticipate this, like, okay, maybe years in the future, somebody with a computer is going to figure out, of course, now anybody can figure out with a computer, that if the Earth is in that position, then like, say, Orion's belt has to be over here or have over here, but it's got to be exactly that place. And if it's not, then you get a problem, which is why the moon mission, you know, that was there. And we'll get into some of the reasons why the other stuff. But that's why that was their answer for the moon, which was they couldn't figure out. It was going to be way too hard, especially in the 60s, to try to figure out exactly where the stars were when an astronaut was standing in this position on this day, because everything was date stamped. So their argument was, let's just remove the stars entirely and just not talk about them. And then make sure the astronauts don't say anything about the stars. Neil Armstrong almost blew it in that Apollo 11 interview, if you ever listened to that, because they asked him about the stars and he kind of was getting all fudgy on it. And the other two guys, you know, that was standing next to him, I think it was Aldrin and the other guy, they were like going, dude, you know, it's like, no, it was absolutely no stars. But he was on the fence there for a second.
I did see, I think he was a NASA whistleblower, sort of looked like a cowboy in a truck, talking about there is no sun and there are no stars.
Oh, Eric Dollard. Interesting guy. He's some people call him the new Tesla, the new Nikola Tesla, and I don't necessarily agree with that. He is very, very smart though, and he did this weird interview where he was sitting in I don't know if it was a truck or a car, but he was, you know, some film student was interviewing him. People can look it up on YouTube. It's easy to find. Just look up Eric Dollard, Dollard, and here, let me kill this. Do you want me to leave this up or do you want me to kill it?
Yeah, whatever you like.
Okay, so he was being interviewed and you know, when people seem to be locked in on something, he was basically talking about the sun. He's going, He's going, the sun is, he goes, it is not what people think it is. It is, he goes, it is giving off light. He goes, but there's no fusion there. He goes, there's nothing behind it. He goes, it's hollow. He goes, it's like a, because he was a really big, I don't believe in everything he says, but he's really up on electricity and how things generate light and how, you know, energy is transferred. And he's going, look, he goes, I don't really know what the sun, he goes, nobody knows what the sun is. He goes, but it's not what you think it is. It is not a giant atomic explosion. He goes, it's almost like it's electric, you know, like it's generating light from somewhere else. And, at that point, you know, in the flat design model, I picked up on that in 2 seconds. It's like, well, yeah, that would make perfect sense, because in a flat design model, you don't have to have it 92 million miles away. You can literally have it, you know, as long as it's super bright, you know, to keep people from staring at it and figuring it out, it could be only a couple hundred miles away and no one would ever know the difference. Basically, what I'm saying is the distance that they put on, you know, 92 million miles away, that's just what NASA's telling you it is. They don't know, you know, no different than the Earth's core, which, you know, I could, you know, we'll get into later. So, but yeah, Eric Dollar, look him up. He's an interesting guy to listen to. Definitely.
We've got a couple of questions coming in, but just to let the person who's writing them know, we'll get to that. We will.
Okay. Let me blow that past some of the other clues. So clue number three was map makers, which was a very interesting one to make because, in fact, I can pull that up on my screen. For some people that don't understand how the world looks, like everyone's seen this. This is, you know, the classroom look. You recognize this, right?
Yep.
So this is when you pull down the map in front of the blackboard. This is the one we've been looking at for at least 100 years, which is the Mercator map. And most people don't understand it's not even close to being accurate, right? It is. They uniformly do stuff to where, you know, it gives a, you know, for shipping lanes and you know, countries' prominence and stuff like that. But that's not really what it looks like. What it looks like is, make sure I get it right here, is this. That is what if you laid out the map flat, that is the perspective. And people say, oh, it looks like kind of skewed. But it's really what it is, because Greenland is way, way smaller than Africa. Europe is tiny compared to South America. South America is huge, but if you look at this map, you know, it equals things out. Europe looks about as big as South America. But the point is, the reason why I brought these two maps up is that, look, even our maps, our general maps are lying to us. Forget about the layout and the shape of the world. The maps aren't even true. They're trying to get this other one. They're trying to get this into the classroom because they're saying, oh yeah, this is, by the way, this is what the world really looks like. And it freaks people out, but it's true. You know, this isn't even a point of debate. So anyway, I'm going to get back to the other map. And that is, so for map makers, what I did was I was looking at maps of the world and I noticed that in the wiki map projections, there was something called the azimuthal equidistant, this map right here. And it was a very, very interesting map because it was proposed by a scientist 1,000 years ago named Al-Biruni, who, you know, most, you know, pull him up. People don't understand what that guy looks like. He was a Persian scientist 1,000 years ago, right? And you're thinking, well, so what, right? So you propose a flat Earth map 1,000 years ago. Thing is, though, what you're looking at here is not the flat Earth map. This is a map that the United States Geological Service, the USGS, is using as their reference map for the world. And you're thinking, okay, that doesn't make any sense. Well, it doesn't make sense because this is also, if you click over here, the identical map, this is the flat Earth map used by the Flat Earth Society. And, you know, it's literally the same map. No difference between those two maps. And let me look here real quick. I didn't have the UN flag in front of me, but I'll dig it up. Give me 1 second. Can you still hear me?
Yeah, I can.
Okay. Give me 1 second. I'll pull up the UN flag. Come on, UN flag. Darn it. One moment. Sorry, I should have had this in front of me. Map makers.
Yeah, there it is.
I'm going to pick a different one though. This one's pretty good. We'll use this one. So it's also the map. Not only is it used by the USGS, but it's also used by the United Nations as their flag. And, you know, it's, in fact, if you look at the map projections, it's the only image that is used by any group. So it's not only used by the United States, you know, as their map of the world, it's used by the United Nations as their flag. And if you look at the United Nations flag, which is, you know, it's very, very obvious, there's no Antarctica on this map. Mm-hmm. At all. It's not on the outer, you know, is it assumed? Is it on the outer edge? Is it supposed to be these giant wreaths? In my opinion, a symbolism of, you know, what's actually out there, this giant barrier that's surrounding the whole thing. But that's what clue three goes into, is the maps. It's one of those curious head scratcher things where, you know, I point at it. But anyway, do you want me to keep going down the list?
Yeah, keep going.
Okay. Clue four is Shell Beach, and that goes into simulations of a dome-like structure that have been used in Hollywood over the years. The most notable being Dark City, which I think is actually an Australian film. Dark City, which was done in the 90s, and it was also done by The Truman Show, which everybody knows, where a person is born into an enclosed world, and he lives there absolutely ignorant of the entire situation, because why would he believe anything else? It touches on how people can be born into a system if it's an enclosed system and never understand it. You know, they believe what they're told. So if they're if they're told the earth is square, they're going to believe the earth is square. But you have to tell them early, because if you don't tell them early enough, it's way harder to convince somebody. Because, you know, if you're looking at really a flat horizon the entire time, then if somebody, you know, came up to you, you know, when you're 15 or 18, you know, it showed you a globe, would you believe the globe? And it might, wouldn't be it easy, you know. Number five is status quo. That goes into sort of the reasoning behind why it's hidden, which is really just a fundamental shift in world thinking and world power. Because, you know, if you're trying to discover the outer edge, if you're trying to discover the enclosed system, you are coming from a science background. You're coming from a very structured government background. You know that there's a chance you're going to lose these things. And so number five goes into what might happen if that, you know, that happened. There would be certain science divisions that would be shut down immediately. Forget about just NASA and their subcontractors. Every college that had an astrophysics or an astronomy department, those would be shut down immediately. There'd be a huge shift to spirituality, because there's so many, like you mentioned, Lisa, so many religious texts have brought it up over the years that, you know, all the religions would really latch on to it. You know, it wouldn't be just Christianity. You know, it'd be, you know, anybody that mentioned it in the past, they would dig it out of their text and they would say, look, we knew it since day one. And that scares the authority horribly. And so that, you know, goes into the decision-making process. Number six was depth perception, because people were asking me, well, how thick would the model have to be? And I really went into, you know, it wouldn't have to be thick at all. And I went to like geologic processes. So most notably volcanic processes, because people will say, well, you know, in a flat model, wouldn't you leave, you know, volcanoes and molten rock to be a natural formation? I was going, why would you do that? You want everything to be controlled. You want everything to be, if you're going to control one thing, you're going to do it all. I mean, if you're going to spend the time to build an 8,000 mile wide enclosed system, you're really going to leave, you know, molten rock to chance? No, it's all going to be, you know, all going to be controlled at some levels.
And at this point, it's good to mention too, that according to the research you did, we have not dug down past 8 miles.
No. No,
nowhere on the planet anybody ever has ever.
Yeah, that's another thing. Excellent point. People don't understand that there are certain things that are assumed by science that is just ludicrous. They're telling you they know what the cross section of this globe is. You know, that they say, oh yeah, we know exactly what, you know, it's what's going all the way through it. But if you look at the actual definition of the geologic system on Wiki, they skirt the issue. They say, oh well, we're extrapolating. And the reason they're extrapolating is no one has drilled below 8 miles anywhere. In the military, you know, may have been able to figure out something, but they're not talking about it, that's for sure. Publicly, there has never been a hole by any mining corporation. You know, mining corporations, they got state-of-the-art stuff, has gone below 8 miles, because at 8 miles, it gets too hot. and the drill bits start failing. They can't do anything because, you know, they just start turning into clay and just, you know, it fails. But, you know, and so it's like, okay, well, if you cannot drilling down further than 8 miles, which I would expect, you know, everything, again, everything in the design came out like expected, because you don't want people to just keep drilling for, you know, and eventually reach something. So you just keep gradually increasing the temperature to the point where they can't drill any further, or they run into molten rock, and that discourages them from doing anything. So on a flat
I'm just sort of trying to recap on where this leaves us in terms of what we've been told officially.
Yeah.
We don't know what's below us further than 8 miles.
Nope.
We don't.
Nope.
We don't know if it's a globe.
Nope.
We don't know what really is hanging out there on the bottom. Not for sure.
Nope.
And if it's flat, we don't know what's beyond this ice edge that goes right around.
No, no. And a lot of people have been asking me that. And I've got my theories on it, but we'll get to that in a minute.
When it comes to going up,
we're going
serious questions about how far we can really go. And
Exactly. The people that are controlling, let's put it, when it comes to going up, no private corporation is involved. So, and what I mean by that is there, you know, the part of the whole NASA thing, you know, was NASA was created to stop, to completely control private companies from doing that. And that was in their defense, that was a great proactive move, even though back in the 60s and 70s, no one could have ever accomplished it, because you need billions of, you know, you need a lot of money. It wasn't
what
until
about Virgin?
I'm sorry, what?
What about Virgin?
Yeah, like Virgin or SpaceX, you know, those guys. You know, when they got to a certain point, you know, it's like, oh yeah, let's do something with NASA, especially since, you know, NASA shut down the space shuttle program. Why'd they shut down? You know, no one's talking about that. But you would make sure at the very least that if these private space programs, you know, started up at that point, you were so far into the game that you could infiltrate them if you wanted to, because, you know, like SpaceX and the Virgin, you know, team, you know, they got to recruit from somewhere. And, you know, how easy would it be to, you know, just, you know, pull some of your guys and saying, okay, you're going to work for this team. You know, you're going to cause delays. You're going to cause, you know, accidents. You're going to do anything you can, because you cannot allow people, you control the information. You cannot allow people in the private sector to get up that high. You can't. It's too dangerous, because if somebody found out, you know, then you've got a security risk. So, and they've done a great job of that so far. So.
Okay. Moving on.
Number 7 was the long haul, which I ended up doing as a two-parter. Long haul, and then number 9 was the magic show. But long haul talked about something. Again, it's something that's been missed, and I'm flipping the globe over to show the southern hemisphere here, which talks about the GPS system. But it also talks about travel routes, and that is if it's a flat. Because I remember I was looking for if I wanted to hide the world. If I want to hide an enclosed model, there's certain things you have to look for. One, of course, is there can't be any legitimate space program. And for those out there, you know, that don't know exactly what I'm talking about, please look into it. The Apollo missions are ridiculous. The space, the International Space Station footage they've been releasing is horrible. It's just awful.
It's really very humorous.
It's just the permed, I guess, two words, permed hair. There are, anyway, that's a tangent.
We're obviously sponsored by some hairspray company.
Oh, there were three better ways you could have handled that, but it doesn't really matter. The second thing you want to look for in an enclosed model is no pictures of the Earth from space, because you can't. And that holds true. There was only one, you know, assumed picture from space ever, you know, and the rest are all composites. Feel free to look it up. There's wonderful videos on that. The third thing,
they're very open about the fact that they're composites.
Yeah, and they're very open. They're composites, and people don't seem people just don't make the leap. They just don't understand it. And believe me, they're nervous about this, because this was not a secret that was going to be able to be kept forever, because it's because we all live here. Meaning, let me get out of this for a second. Because we all live here, it's like trying to hide something from your roommates, if that makes sense. It's like trying to hide something from inside your own apartment, from your own roommates. You can't hide something forever, like a teddy bear or a pack of cigarettes or whatever you want. Sooner or later, somebody's accidentally going to find that. But the most obvious one was in a globe model, there are shortcuts. Meaning, if you're traveling from, say, South America to Australia, you're just going across the South Pacific Ocean. It's super easy. It's a straight shot. It's only 7,400 miles. But and you can go the other way too. You know, the globe, you have different ways of going around this. But if it's pancaked and it's a flat model, then there's only one way to go. And that's where things start getting weird. I was going, well, if it's pancaked, then they can't lie about the flight routes, especially since on a flat model, and here, let me pull this up again, sorry. Can you see that?
The flat, yes.
Yeah, so on a flat model, what we're looking at here is, if this is literal, and you're thinking, well, no, it's just a squished version of the globe. No, if this is literal, if this is flat or way more flat than it is a globe, then the distance between Australia over here and the distance between South America over here is way longer than it should be. Meaning it's way longer. This distance is not the same as going across the ocean, because you notice let's say I want to go across the ocean, it would take this really weird long roundabout way. Basically, this distance right here, this doesn't become 7,400 miles anymore. It becomes much longer. So you have to trick people into thinking that they are going, you know, 7,400 miles. But the only way you can do that is you have to cut across. Right? You have to cut across the middle. And that doesn't make any sense, especially if you're looking at a globe. If you're looking at a globe to get from South America to Australia, you don't go over the North Pole, or you don't go near the North Pole, or you don't go across North America. But on a flat map, you do. And that's where everything starts to fall apart for these guys, because there's certain...
It explains why if you try to leave Australia, you always end up in Dubai.
Yeah. There's two ways they hide it. The one is obvious and the other one's not so obvious. The one that's obvious is you make sure there's connections. So traveling from here to here may seem ridiculous if it's nonstop, but if you connect through the Middle East or North America, yeah. So why in the world, if you're going from Sydney to Buenos Aires, would you go through San Francisco? It doesn't make any sense unless you're on this map. If you're on this map, it makes perfect sense, because you're going from here, you're going to San Francisco, and then you're going, you know, a little jog over here to South America. And 95% people look this up, try to book a flight from somewhere in South America to somewhere in Australia, and 95% of the time you will run into connections, and they will be ridiculous connections. They won't make any sense. And the flight times are ridiculous. You know, it's supposed to be a 12-hour flight. You know, 7,400 miles. But if you're doing this on a flat model, there'll be some connections that take you 3 days. And, you know, they'll bounce you over with huge layovers all over the place. Unfortunately, you can't do it with 100% of the flights, because it's going to raise too many eyebrows. So what you do is you make make some nonstops. But there's a problem with nonstops. And that is, nonstop means you literally will have to fly this route, and you're going to confuse a lot of people, including the pilots. So what they do is, and this is where it gets real, real clever, is there's a site called, in fact, here, let me pull it up here. There's a site called planetracker.net. Can you see that one, that screen?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, planetracker.net. It tracks real time, and people can open this up 24 hours a day, real time. Every flight, every commercial flight in the world, you know, we're assuming that, you know, some of the Russian ones, you know, they're on their own thing. But every commercial flight in the world gets tracked in this in real time. So you can zoom in and you can see all the planes. Well, there's a problem with this map. And ignore the yellow and the red colors. For whatever reason, the United States delays its flight information by 5 minutes. So that's what it says when you see the yellow flights. But down in these southern oceans, the South Pacific Ocean, the South Atlantic, the Indian Ocean, there's nothing there. And you're thinking, and you know, you look up in the northern hemisphere, there's planes flying all over the place. But down here, it's a ghost town, and you can't figure out why. And so I spent about a week staring at this.
Okay, yeah, see, I think I see what you're saying. The North Pacific Ocean has planes.
Oh, yeah.
All over the ocean.
Yeah.
The South Pacific's got nothing.
Yeah, there's nothing there. And you're thinking, well, this must have been just, you know, this is a frame in time. This isn't the live shot, but you can pull up the live shot today, and it's not going to look any different right now. And it takes 5 seconds. But the reason why I was doing this was people saying, well, there's nonstops, you know, from like Santiago, Chile to wherever. That's the big one, you know, because there's only a handful of nonstops. And that should raise the flags right there. People should, like, look, in America, you know, the northern hemisphere, we can get nonstops anywhere. You know, it's just a question of the cheapest one. The Southern Hemisphere, there's some cities you cannot get nonstops to. You know, from key cities like Sydney to certain parts in South America, literally no nonstops any day. It doesn't really matter. There's a handful of nonstops, and I'm trying to figure out, okay, how are you hiding the fact that, how are you hiding the fact, if you're doing a nonstop flight from South America to Australia, how are you hiding this? Because you can't allow the GPS system to track it. Right? You cannot allow this plane to fly over this on a nonstop because sooner or later someone's going to notice. So what they did was, and this was the clever part, they turned them off. So every flight in the Southern Hemisphere, as soon as they get offshore, I think it's like 150, 200 miles, they just disappear. The logs are erased. They drop off the map and they are not tracked. And they are not tracked literally until an hour from their destination when, you know, all of a sudden out of the blue, they pop back on the map. And everything's great again, and nobody questions it.
So are you telling me that you could sit in front of your computer and watch a plane take off from, say, New York?
Yep.
And travel across the North Atlantic?
Oh, yeah. Yeah, these planes are northern.
Watch it in real time, traveling right across the ocean and have it land somewhere in Europe.
Yeah.
But if it takes off from Sydney...
Yep.
And it's supposedly just going over the South Pacific.
Yep.
To Chile. It'll disappear and then reappear.
It has to. And this is every once in a while I will defend these guys for the decisions they make because it's the lowest maintenance of the decisions they could have gone with. And that is it has to disappear because you can't show them how the plane is getting from point A to point B for the nonstop. But unfortunately, they had to do it for all of them. So even though there's just a handful of nonstops that would screw people up, they can't draw attention to these nonstops by making them disappear. So what they do is anything below the equator, anything that goes over the ocean, every flight is erased. Every one of them. And it's for them, it's a necessary evil. Unfortunately, there's been people that have been taking notice the last couple of years. And I had to at least talk about it because it's for me, it's also a question of safety. It's like, look, you know, it's kind of a sore subject with some people. Look, that Malaysian flight, that wasn't on the GPS system. Not a chance. Nothing's there. There's nothing ever down here. You can look for days and days. There's a little island off of Madagascar. That's a perfect example. People say, oh, there's a plane in the Indian Ocean sometimes. No, it's not. It's on an island. But when it leaves that island heading towards Madagascar, it disappears. It's ridiculous, but it's one of the rules. So the long way around, I'm trying to get back to this, is that you have to do that to protect the globe model. You cannot show people, again, you know, if I pull up this model again, you can't show people that it's going from Australia to South America by going straight shot. Because if it's a nonstop, it's going to screw with their minds. People won't understand it. In fact, if you showed 100 people a plane going from here to here on a normal map, like, because it would have to go, oh God, how would it even go? It would go like, it would go up and then down, right? Mm-hmm. So it'd be this weird arc on this map and people wouldn't understand it. It's like, why in the world would a flight nonstop go over the United States and then back down to South America? It doesn't make any sense, but it absolutely makes sense here. And that for me was a giant thing because every flight that I looked at, every angle, if it made sense here, then it just proved it out. And again,
it's going to make you wonder about pilots though.
About what?
Pilots.
Oh, the pilots. Yeah. But think about it this way. I almost treat pilots like I do astronomers because there's certain groups which will never ever buy into this ever. Astronomers, obviously, because that's their job. You know, their whole job is like, well, we're a little ball in space, and we're going to look at stuff. But for pilots, think of, and I talked about this in one of the videos, which was if you're a pilot, think of the leap of faith you've got to make to do this. I mean, most of it's all autopilot now, anyway. You know, remember the GPS system, the same one that's controlling this stuff here. The GPS system works against them. So the GPS, you know, the entire plane flies itself. So most of the time they don't care. If they look below and they see something that doesn't make sense to them, what's the first thing they're going to think? They're going to think, they're wrong, or they must have dozed off or something, that, you know, they're the leap out of this makes no sense to them. And if, let's say, you're the rare pilot that knows, who are you going to call? You're going to call the FAA? They'll ground you in 2 seconds. You're going to say, you know, if you said, hey, there's something wrong with the GPS system, yeah, maybe they'll talk to you, but they're just going to give you the runaround. You go to the FAA and say, hey, by the way, I think the maps are wrong, and I think it's actually flat, you know, the globe doesn't match up. Oh, yeah, you're going to be on
a desk.
Yeah, you're out of a job, period. It's never going to happen. So anyway, that was the long haul and the magic show. The magic show, in fact, number 9 I did deliberately. So if you're watching number 7, and I feel bad because some people have contacted me after number 7 and said, they keep mentioning that Santiago Chile flight, even though it's like, what, you didn't understand that, you know, there's only like 5 nonstops in the entire Southern Hemisphere. But because they kept bringing it up, I had to do number 9, and number 9 was specifically to deal with, that's how I found the GPS being shut off, and it's still shut off today. And I don't imagine they're going to fix it anytime soon. And then number 10 was Hiding God, probably my most controversial one, which really went into the religious texts, more specifically the firmament. But it was more of a wake-up call to people. You know, I said, look, if you've gone through 1 through 9 and the guide, then there's certain things you can do to see if this thing can be more revealed, more wide open. The first of which is to talk about what we were just talking about, the GPS system. It's like, look, contact your representatives and say, look, we've got fellow citizens. You don't say flat earth, but we've got fellow citizens that are flying without GPS over oceans, you know, supposedly. So what's the deal there? You know, just kind of, you know, get that buzz going. The second one was contact anybody in the resource industry. You know how oil companies are. I mean, there's no way in a million years that an oil company does not have the lobbying power to get anywhere. They're trying to, you know, up in the States, they're trying to get into national parks, and they're winning. They're going to get into the national parks. And these same guys who have unlimited resources, you're telling me they can't get into Antarctica where there's nothing environmentally, you know, it's all under an Environmental Protection Act now, but in 1959 it wasn't. But now it's like, what are you damaging? There's no animal life. There's no plant life. There's no indigenous population. There's no old ruins anywhere. There's supposedly nothing. But you can't risk having these companies go down there, because if somebody's straight off course accidentally with a helicopter or a plane, it could get ugly. But that shows you how big it is. And then the third thing for number 10 was, the churches. I'm sorry, where basically I said, look, you know, this is kind of a big deal, because from a religious standpoint, it's a big deal. You know, if some sort of barrier was found, if intelligent design was found, the thing that science and religion have been butting heads about for years, then is it really fair that science hit it? I mean, let's call it what it is. I mean, if it is an enclosed structure, well, then the question of any, you know, spiritual, you know, the God side of the equation, that just all of a sudden materializes instantly. And, you know, science has a lot of explaining to do. And, you know, it's, I think it would be, you know, in religion's best interest to see if they could sort this out. But that was my take. And so, yeah, I've gotten a few letters about that saying I might be on, you know, getting myself into trouble there.
Well, hopefully we've given people enough reasons to start questioning.
I hope so.
And the research is out there, and the explanations are there for the seasons, the equinoxes, the precession, a day and night. They're all explained on how this works on a flat Earth model. And I'm just gonna share my screen for a minute, because I've got an image here. Where is it? This one. Now, I think this is an older Vedic. Vedic.
Okay. Yeah. Oh, yeah. Yeah, I see it. Yeah.
And because this is one of the questions that comes up. Okay, so where do the stars come from? Where does the sun and the moon, where does everything sit, the other planets? And this is one concept, but it's a very common one throughout history and with all the different cultures and religions, is something along these lines. So what you've got is the flat earth. You've got what they call, you could planetary, you get different layers, essentially. And the Vedics even made, once upon a time, a device that kind of looked like, or was put together like a clock. And you had these different plates that represented each of the different layers. You had one for the Earth, you had the planetary layer, you know, the sun, the moon, and everything sat on top of one another. And when you look down through the center of this device, and you could move each of the layers as things were supposedly moving around and above the Earth. And they were incredibly, incredibly accurate. And these devices are 1,000 or more years old. But here's where it starts to get, oh my God, really interesting. All the implications of this. And all the people that it brings into question. I mean, first, to pull off a lie like this, you know, you've got to have every space agency on the Earth,
yep,
involved.
Yep.
But at the same time, I can imagine your average staff member of NASA, for example, working in one of those huge rooms and it's full of screens. They don't know.
Information
being fed to those screens is coming from. If they're told it's from a camera that's roaming on Mars or wherever, but they don't know.
No, it's a need to know basis. And if you don't mind me jumping in just for a second here, let me show you something. Please. I'll give you an example. And one of these days he's going to figure it out. I'm using his name, but I had a neighbor whose name was Wayne Ottinger, and he was about as deep into NASA as you can. There's Neil, there's Buzz, there's Wayne. That was my neighbor. Took care of his cat. And Wayne, what was he doing? He built this. If people recognize this, this is the Lunar Landing Research Vehicle. This was the prototype for what they were going to use when they're landing on the moon, mm-hmm, which was very interesting. Now, they didn't use this model, which I think was strange because they spent years on it, millions and millions of dollars. But from a production standpoint, you couldn't use this model because it was a convertible, really. This little thing here was just a little wheelhouse. There wasn't really much to it. But the point was, is that even though he was about as close to these guys as you could get, these two guys were the only, you know, it was a need to know basis. So he was the garage mechanic that was building all this stuff, but there was no reason to tell him and his buddy over here, you know, whereas you had Neil and Buzz who, you know, had to be told eventually because, you know, when they initially started the program, they were going to be heroes, and I feel bad because, you know, Neil Armstrong, it obviously weighed on him for years and years, all the way to his dying day. But I'm sorry, to more to your point, though, absolutely, from a NASA or any space organization, the need to know is compartmentalized to the point where it'd be just a handful of people that would know. I mean, honestly, as far as even the people that are faking the stuff on ISS, you know, the International Space Station, you know, the people that are going up in those flight simulator things, you know, simulating anti-gravity, would you even need to tell them? All you have to do is say, look, you sign a non-disclosure, you're going to act like we tell you to act. But, you know, if they asked them why, I don't think they tell them. It's too big to tell them. You know, as far as, you know, real high department heads in NASA, then yeah, maybe. And as far as other space agencies, have some fun, guys. Look up Chinese space bubbles on YouTube. You know, the fact that it appears that just about every simulated exterior shot from any space agency is shot in the underwater simulator, which, yep, you know, which James Cameron helped perfect because he figured out if you put layers of rubber balls on the top of the pool, like he did when he simulated the movie The Abyss, you can simulate perfect darkness or anything you want, or a perfect, you know, setting for a green screen. It's quite clever. Or people look up the people miss this, which was JAXA, J-A-X-A, the Japanese moon space program that supposedly sent HD cameras around the moon. And everything goes through NASA. That's the big key here. If you're a country and you're doing a space program, you have to go through NASA. You do not do it independently. They tell you what to do. They show you how to do it because it's not real. They're not dumb. They're not going to let you fire a rocket up and just crash. So anyway, sorry. That was my little tangent.
Well, there's several things this brings into question. Whistleblowers.
Yeah.
A couple of which I've even interviewed who have talked about being on Mars. Now, one of the interesting things about the interview I did with Andrew Bishago, the Jump Room to Mars whistleblower, towards the end of that interview, he mentioned that they discovered while they were on Mars through firing a weapon that it hit the ceiling. And they realized they were in an enclosed environment.
When they were on Mars or when they were on Earth?
Mars.
Okay.
And I said, well, then how can you be sure you're on Mars? If you're in an enclosed environment, that could be an enclosed environment anywhere. And I didn't get an answer to my satisfaction on that one. So to me, I mean, they were put, he's put into an elevator for 30 minutes. I think he believes it. I'm not doubting what he believes was his experience.
Sure.
But there's nothing, I don't think there was anything that he could really, really, really say that was definitive evidence that he was not on this planet. Based on the experience, based on his observations, that could have been a major psyop that was done on him and his colleagues.
Think of it this way, and I've got a couple of more examples for you. If you wanted to fake it, there's certain things you'd want to do on a regular basis. One is you would want to have regular stories. And, the fact that every major newspaper or internet thing has, they have weather, they have business, and they have space. And just about every month, NASA's making some sort of announcement about something, right? To make sure it's reinforced in your head that they're still, relevant and viable and all this stuff. But it also reinforces like, oh yeah, right, we're still in space. Oh yeah, right, we're still in space. But there's also a couple other clever things you can do. And whoever thought of this, really, I hope they get a raise for these ideas. And that is you can plant stories that raise people's attention. Like, for example, the face on Mars, right? That great story. Or that weird hexagram thing at the top of Saturn, right? And people don't understand. It's like, well, one, where are those pictures coming from, right? Obviously. But it's a layer that they're putting in that people completely bypass. It's not the face on Mars that's important. It's not the weird thing of the hexagram on the top of Saturn that's important. What's important is you're looking at it and going, hey, that's strange, but you're going, well, it's strange that, out in space, it's reinforcing the fact, the globe model. That's all it's doing. People making, well, it's assumed, I'm looking at the face on Mars, which immediately makes this a given. If there's a face on Mars and that's real, that means I'm obviously on Earth. And that's reinforced time and time again. Oh, yeah, we sent out space probes past Neptune. Oh, wow, I'm immediately on a globe. They do it through association. And that part is clever because it's from a psyop point of view, they don't have to try very hard because most people believe this anyway. If you believe
it. I've got to find that image that I just brought up for you again because there's something I wanted to point out.
Yeah.
Where did it go? Damn. I've just lost it. Where did it go? You keep talking. Sorry.
It's okay. It's a great little... It's a great little nugget. So again, just look at the news and go back in time in regular interviews. Regular intervals. NASA always mentions these things. Oh, we've got a probe here. Oh, we've got something coming back here. Oh, let's not forget the Mars rover, which apparently was supposed to have shut down like 5-6 years ago. Something even more than that. It's like, oh yeah, it's still running. We're still doing stuff with it. It's like when you believe they're putting your suspension of disbelief. Out so far that you immediately come back to this, and that is if you're thinking about something on Mars, if you're thinking about something on Neptune, then this already happened. And people miss it. And it's like, because you know, we've been conditioned for so long, it's like, oh, it's a given, it's a given. They just keep beating it into you. Anyway, go ahead.
Well, when I looked at this image, I thought this, something about this was interesting because, you know, if you've been a conspiracy theorist long enough, you know about Saturn and the worship of, or the supposed worship of Saturn and the cube and all of that stuff, right?
Yeah.
The top layer of this particular image is seventh heaven.
Uh-huh. Saturn. I see it.
And Saturn. Okay, so if, I mean, I'm purely just, this is the stuff that's been going on in my head, but if you know that this is the structure that we're dealing with, and seventh heaven, which is associated with Saturn, is just below the throne of God.
Okay.
Makes sense to, if you're going to worship anything.
Nice.
Q Saturn.
I hear you. I also noticed in there that, and what, this is the pre-Copernican universe. I also noticed that in that picture, it mentions the invisible pillars, which is in several different religions, the three invisible pillars that, and I didn't get that for the longest time either, which was, it's three pillars that hold up the sky. And they're really specific about that. And it's like, why would you need three pillars to hold up the sky if it's a globe? Right? But it works again, perfect in an enclosed system because you're going to need some sort of heck, there could be reinforcement structures out there. In a sort of dome structure, even the ones we build, it's a little dicey if you make it out too far. You'd want some reinforcement here and there, you know, whether they're, you know, real things, whether they're force field things, hard to say. But you know, I love this model. And again, every culture has a version of it. It doesn't matter what religion you're looking in. Nobody started with the globe. Nobody. And again, for those out there, I know we're living in modern times and it's an archaic thing, but you got to remember that up until 500 years ago, this didn't exist. This wasn't here. And then
it seemed to be. And up until 50 years ago, we didn't have any proof.
Yeah. And up until 50 years ago, there was no proof of it, literally no proof of this. And the question was, once you found proof, you know, and I believe that it was probably going to be a natural process by whoever built this place. Whether it's the globe or the flat model, but definitely the flat model. If I think it was a natural process that eventually the civilization that was down here was going to find it, and there was going to be this natural shift, you know, to whatever, you know, however they were going to deal with it. But what happened was, is that the authority in question, and when I say the authority, I'm just lumping up governments, extremely rich people, and royalty, just lumping up into one group. You can say the power elite, but I don't think it has the same ring to it. They decided that it was a need to know issue. And they decided that it would have been better to just not tell anybody. And again, look at the moves they made, you know, sealing off an entire continent, creating a space program that is just full of holes, hiding all the airline flights in the Southern Hemisphere. It's gotten to the point now where the technology that they've been using, you know, recently is working against them, because civilians, you know, have access to stuff now where, you know, 20, 30 years ago, they wouldn't have had access to. And people are starting to slowly figure it out. And, you know, you and I are talking about this, right? 2 years ago.
This is not a conversation I ever thought I'd be having.
No. And again, I set out to disprove. This is not what I wanted to do. I didn't want to crush this thing. I wanted to do, you know, get on with my life. But this is one of those things where it's going, if this is actually real and everything that I've seen, I mean, everything that I've seen points to it, then yeah, it's the mother of all conspiracies. It's the last conspiracy, really.
The other thing that brings into question is ETs, extraterrestrial races. Where do they fit in?
I've had about.
Well, see, if we take the flat model.
Yeah.
And it's got this ice rim that probably goes for hundreds of miles.
Thousands. It would be 20,000 miles around at least. Yeah. What and 2 miles high, by the way.
And 2 miles high.
Yeah.
What if everything's on a flat plane? Now I've my mind has gone into all kinds of places. I've looked at toroidal fields and the ETs and you know, how does this all fit in? What if everything's on a flat plane and it's actually infinite?
And just keeps going.
And you've got the Earth in the center. And there's talk of Earth being a black hole.
Yeah.
You've got a barrier being this ice rim.
Yeah.
And then you've got the what we call the extraterrestrial realms, dimensions, yeah. races.
Yeah.
In ever increasing circles going out. And that's whether we've got a dome, whether we've got a little dome firmament, whatever, around us.
Yeah.
And then there's another one that yeah. encapsulates, and it's sort of like snow globes within snow globes within snow globes.
Oh, yeah, the Russian stacking doll argument. Yeah.
Yeah, that kind of deal.
Yeah.
I hadn't heard of that. I didn't.
Okay. It's very possible. The thing you mentioned, the infinite thing, that's funny because Matt from the NASA channel, and by the way, I do a quick thing to Matt here because I know he's going to eventually watch this. Look, she's trying to get a hold of you, so try to track her down. You really got to talk to her. But Matt from the NASA channel actually mentioned this to me when we were talking on the phone. He's going, because he didn't like, you know, being an artist and everything, he didn't like the whole enclosed, structured system where he's like, going, look, what if it just keeps going and there's no barrier? And I was going, well, yeah, but in that case, you're going to have people exploring and it's not, they wouldn't have made the moves that they made. It wouldn't have been as decisive. You know, it's like, you know, once you get to a certain point, yeah, they would have figured it out eventually, but I don't know if you would have shut it down immediately, but it doesn't really matter. The point was, his thought was, yeah, it continues on and then there's our section and then there's other sections. You know, my argument, which I told the people, I said, well, one, it was an enclosed system. We're not the first ones in it, obviously, you know, because, you know, how many underwater cities do you have to find? You know, we're not the first people that have rented this apartment. and of course, why would you? Why would you? You're not going to throw away a perfectly good dome, you know, or a perfectly good enclosed system. But at the same time, you're not going to just make one either. You're going to make multiples, and for various reasons. I just can't. It's hard for me to, you know, me saying that from a flat Earth point of view. It's hard for me to get my head around that there'd be only one. You know, you'd put more, and so it's a question. Okay, if it, you know, is there us? And which for me reinforces my argument of a firmament type situation where we can't go anywhere and run amok, because if we would cross contaminate. Oh, you know, Lord knows we found another world. What we might do there, you know, and plus, you know, you get these, you know how it goes. You get these myths of other world, other people coming into ours, and talking about, you know, that same sort of structure, and over the years we're developing into something. And I know some of that stuff has been out there. Anyway, I digress. But I like your thing where it just keeps going. Absolutely. Cause people ask me all the time, they say, is there space, you know, outside of this? And it's like, well, yeah, you could have outer space, but why not just, you know, it just seems that everything in this model was designed so efficiently that you wouldn't waste space. Kind of like that Carl Sagan quote, you know, so much empty space out there. If you simulate it and people buy it, then hey, just do that.
So. You know, I think based on my experience having these conversations with some people, mm-hmm. the initial response is, if they really start to go, oh, wow, this works, this actually starting to make sense.
Yeah.
It feels the idea of it being enclosed is somehow a sad thing initially. I feel like ultimately.
Yeah.
How do I explain this? By projecting out like that, by creating this universe in the model that we've got, this heliocentric thing. First, I mean, what it did was it took us out of being the center of creation. Okay. So it messed with human psychology completely.
Sure.
And yet whenever you see, and there's lots of memes out there that do this, where that wants to compare Earth to the sun and then compares the sun to the size of something else to something else, and then you end up being such a small little speck.
Yep.
That you appear off the map. You're too small. Yeah. So it put us in a place of total insignificance. We're a speck of dust on a speck of dust on a speck of dust.
Agreed.
And we lost our place.
Yeah.
Psychologically and spiritually. So there's that's been done, this whole hijacking of our consciousness in that respect. And then they create this whole universe and galaxies for us to continually be looking out at and projecting ourselves out to.
Sure.
So we're not even, it takes the emphasis off us, it takes us off the planet we're on. All our energy goes out there. If this is true,
yep.
Then what that does is bring us back to us, in my opinion, because there's nowhere else to go. If there's a firmament, if there's a wall,
yep.
Where all we got, in a way? And that's not a bad thing. What I mean by where all we've got is that this...
We're all in it together.
All in it together. Yeah, and no, if there is a creator of all of this,
yep.
Then it's been created for us to have that experience and go back to within ourselves to the... Oh, this gets back to also the whole idea of I was looking at toroidal fields and all of this. When it comes to looking at all the ET information, you know, I mean, it's said that they're all incredibly interested in this planet. You know, all the attention's on this planet right now. What if the attention is here is because it's the center? And the whole energetic toroidal field thing is coming from the outside in.
Yeah.
And the ascension process, from a spiritual perspective, this evolution that we're going through is all about coming through here. So this planet and us on it are somehow the key to this. I don't know if I'm making any sense.
No, I agree. And to your first point, because I did make a video, which I didn't really talk about, called Creative Force, because there were people emailing me saying that I was giving them small world syndrome initially. It's like, yay, I felt, you know, like it was this tiny speck in the middle of nowhere, but now I feel kind of claustrophobic. I was going, no, you don't think like that. It changes everything. The model becomes, it concentrates everything here. And I'm just, because it's me, I'm not going to delve into the metaphysical too much. I'll leave that to you. But if everything's concentrated here, then we're all in it together. Wars, that stops immediately. No, there, because if you're fighting another guy on another hill, you know, exchanging gunfire, and you know, and this model comes into play, you're not anymore. It breaks down everything. You know, color barriers, race barriers, language barriers, the whole thing starts coalescing again. And that
because
we're
all living in the same apartment.
Yeah, you're all living in the same apartment, so you might as well get along. And not only you're living in the same apartment, but you got a really big landlord above you, you know, living above you. And so you not say you should be on your best behavior, but you should be acting better than you are now. And it all, for me, you know, I kind of changed my mind on this, because initially I thought, you know, that, you know, might be a knee-jerk reaction, and that religion might, you know, go on a rampage against science and, you know, might turn bad. But at the same time, if there is concrete evidence of a design system, then that change, that tempers it. And for me, you know, not to be too optimistic, but why wouldn't it get better? You know, everybody should get along, you know, way, way better than they should. And I know, you know, there's, you know, every industry that revolves around war. Yeah, you guys are going to have to shut down. No question. And I'm sorry about that, but you had a good run. But the world deserves this. You know, there's a lot of people out there that feel alone and, you know, detached from the universe, especially, you know, when they think they're an insignificant speck. And this changes it. This brings everything back in, and we all become, it's corny as it sounds, you know, we all become one big family overnight, you know, with the technology that's out there. And I mentioned that, you know, in Hiding God, you know, the word would spread so much quicker than it would have in 1956, 1958, that, you know, I think there'd just be this overwhelming feeling of just change everywhere. And yeah, there'd be a shock to the system, no question. But I still think it'd be a real positive thing, and so I'm putting it out there.
And you're doing a great job.
Well, thank you. I'm trying.
So, I know that there's people who have a lot of technical questions still.
Oh yes, probably geologic. Go ahead, throw them at me.
Well, no, I was just going to suggest, I'd like to open it up to callers, but I was going to suggest to people that if you do have those technical questions, the answers are there. You just have to Google it or YouTube it. There are people, if you've never looked at it before, you'll probably be as surprised as I was as just how many people are putting information out there and explaining the model. They're explaining the seasons. They're explaining night and day. They're explaining tides. They're explaining any question you've got, GPS, it's all there if you want to do the research. And I'm, Mark, I'm going to invite you back because there's so much more to talk about. So
okay.
Sometime in the next couple of weeks.
I'm more than happy to do it.
And because this is such a huge subject. And the theme, especially that I've personally and publicly been kind of working with, is that, yes, we are all one over the last couple of years. And the evidence is there that we're sort of, the whole idea of oneness is really permeating our collective. And that it's the time of transparency. All the lies are starting to be revealed.
Yeah.
And in terms of darkness, we've been covering that too, because the light's been shone in all the dark places. But in terms of conspiracy and lies, this is exciting. If this is real and this is true, then this is exciting, because there's nowhere, I don't think there's anything bigger than this one. There's nowhere to go from this. If this is the one that's being exposed now, then it's like, you know, we're nearly there.
Yeah.
So I do want to open it up to questions. There's a number of ways you can do this and join us.
Okay.
And I will actually, you can either call in. If you're watching from lisamharrison.com, what you will see is on the player, above my screen keeps
changing. Oh, am I going to be doing this?
No.
Oh, you're just going to rattle off the questions?
I'm just going to rattle off some numbers for the people to call in.
Oh, so okay.
You can do it on your phone or on your computer. It's an American number, so plus one if you're outside the States, 415-762-9988. And the ID number is 742-504-9603. And also, if you are on your computer, I am going to, for those of you who are already savvy with Zoom, which is the software we use, you can click on that link and you can join us in the room. Someone's just mentioned that I also did an interview with a guy called John Lamb Lash, who studied the Nag Hammadi, and he's Sophia. He has the Sophia myth. And I actually don't see a contradiction with John's Sophia myth and what we have here either, with a flat earth or an enclosed system.
Yeah, take your pick.
Yeah. Now, you mentioned early on, you said, and we'll get to that, you said you're saying it's not dead flat.
No. I don't think I've got a really good model in front of you. I've been told that using the Orlando Ferguson's flat and stationary map is probably not the good example, so I'll just tell you about it. From a flatness point of view, it's obviously not purely flat, because the sun and the moon, you'd have to do some strange things. There appears to be some sort of bulge over the North Pole. So imagine like a roulette table. So instead of just a flat thing, you know, roulette table's got that bulge in the center and then it kind of flattens out. That's what it would look like.
What leads you to that conclusion, though?
And again, I'm not going to flash up the animation. There's some videos, because of how the sun, the reason why I latched onto it was how the sun and the moon, when they travel, if sun and moon are inside this system, if they are way, way closer, you know, if they're only a few hundred miles up and three-dimensional objects, you need a hump to accurately, or to give a better perception of sunrise and sunset and moonrise and sunset. Otherwise, you get some weird angles. You know, if the sun's at a certain point, it'll shine across everything. You need something. You need a three-dimensional object for it to go around. If that gives it justice. Anyway, if people want to check out there's an animation that gives a perfect example of it. It's one of the likes, but it's on YouTube, and I think the video is called "The Final One Is That One," Space Moon. And that shows Matt from, you know, just for a second, from the NASA channel. But if you forward to like 8 minutes and 40 seconds in that video, and I forget, I'll have to see if I can dig up an animation. But if you look on 8 minutes and 40 seconds on that video, you'll get a better idea of what I'm talking about, because it'll literally show the sun and the moon going around this model. But yeah, the three-dimensional model of this, there's so few of them out there that, because again, the topic just has not been broached over the decades. There's a few out there, but from a three-dimensional standpoint, no. But there's some I put in my videos, I don't think they're as good as others. So
when you can't question this without questioning every aspect.
Of course.
NASA and what's in space, and that includes satellites.
Oh yeah, yeah. And people will bring up satellites to me, and they'll say, well, you know, people worked on these satellites and they built them, and you know, they put them up there. And there's two arguments here. One is if the moon mission, which has been shot so full of holes at this point, if you believe the moon mission, I feel badly for you, because it's been just trounced. You know, it's the internet just had its way with it, and the International Space Station at this point. Again, the footage they're releasing up there is beyond horrible. It's absolutely horrible. If you want to have some fun, look up YouTube. Just type in ISS or International Space Station and then two words, permed hair. That's all you have to look up. You'll see it. It's horrible. But the point is, if you're faking people on the space station, then how can you trust anything that's up there as far as any satellites? Anything that above a commercial jet airliner, you should be suspect of. Because if NASA's going to fake one thing, they have to fake everything, including satellites. They're saying, oh, well, you know, satellite TV, you're going to bounce up and going, look, you can compensate with cables. You can compensate with towers. You can do anything you want down here to fake it. Trust me, it's not that hard. The other part I was going to mention was, because people say, oh, there's so many people involved in jobs and you're setting up satellites. I'm going, well, yeah, there were people that built the Saturn V rocket, you know, for the Apollo missions. But the only reason that Saturn V rocket was even built, which is really just a giant ballistic missile, was that they had to have an event to fake the picture. Meaning you can't just start handing out flyers of pictures of the Earth. You have to have the technology to at least fake the reason you were up there reasonably to take the picture. So how can I even believe any of that if when the ISS stuff is so horrible and the moon stuff is so dated at this point that you guys really should have kept Kubrick on the payroll for the very end, because he would have never let that stuff get past production, never.
So the satellites that do supposedly like Google Earth.
Yeah.
Where does that footage come from then?
Well, no, you can take...
Are there satellites up there? They're just not at the height that they're...
Yeah, if there are satellites, I'm not saying there aren't pictures taken, absolutely, but you can do... Here's the thing, though. I am not saying that there's nothing above commercial airliners, because we've got some, at least in the States, we've got some outstanding spy planes. I mean, we've got spy planes now that they won't even declassify, you know, like the SR-71 Blackbird. And then the Aurora project, which supposedly doesn't even exist. You can send planes up to a high enough altitude with cameras to simulate just about anything you need with a satellite. No question in my mind. So if you need images for Google Earth, you could, you know, how many sweeps you need with a plane. In fact, it's easier with spy planes than it is actual physical satellites, and cheaper.
You could just have a camera on every commercial plane that...
Sorry, you know what? That's a good one. I'm gonna have to steal that. You're absolutely right. You could put a plane on every commercial plane, put a camera on every commercial plane in the world, and you cover the world in a matter of a month, if that. Yeah, that'd be good too. But no, the short version is: look, if I can't trust the missions they've sent up so far, and since every satellite has to get approval from NASA in one degree or another, then I can't trust, you know, that anything's up there. And yes, it can be simulated. And I love your commercial airline thing. I'm totally stealing that.
Yeah. Okay. You're welcome to it. Okay, let me just have a look. If the Earth is flat, then where does the heat come from? Is the sun even hot?
Good one. You mean the heat from, and I totally recommend, because you may have watched this, Lisa, the Matt from the NASA channel, his original video where he was sitting on the couch and he basically, you know, opened up. But there was an interesting thing there that a lot of people forget about in that interview, and that was when he, and I totally buy it, when he was talked to, you know, by the NASA people before, you know, they lost contact, was that the entire system, the entire closed system was based on temperature.
Yeah.
And if the enclosed system is based on temperature, then most of the temperature is underneath. You know, you can control it. You know, it's all the temperature mechanisms are going to be below us. Yeah, the sun's going to give off some heat, obviously, but no more than, you know, a big light bulb in I know it sounds cheesy, but a big light bulb in a big area like a terrarium. You can do so much more below than you can above. So the short answer to that, as far as where does the heat come from? I think mostly below. With the system, that's how I would do it. Because you can do it two ways. You can do it with the geologically with any lava system, any magma system. You also combine, you know, you use that in the underwater conveyor belt system that does all the water, you know, temperature variances. You build that in, and then the jet stream. It's really just one giant air conditioning system. Also brilliant. People just forget it's all on scale. You know, it's tough to get your head around, but if you're building an enclosed system that's 8,000 miles across, what can't you do? You know, people are saying, oh, well, how you do this? Are you kidding? If you built the actual structure, the things you can do, you know, think of the things we can do now. Multiply that by 100,000, and that's really what you got here. So.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I do want to hear more from Matt if I get the chance to talk to him about if the temperature aspect of that, because he said the whole system was explained.
Yeah, like the whole, yeah, the guy broke down the entire thing and literally the entire system ran on temperature, which I thought was fascinating. And that's one of those little nuggets. It's like, you know, people say, oh, yeah, he's faking and everything. And it's like, I'm a pretty creative guy and I couldn't have made that up out of thin air. It's one of those nuances you didn't have to throw into the story, and he did. And again, I feel for the guy because, you know, being non-conspiracy guy and you drop something like that. Oh, by the way, you're living in an enclosed system. I would have gone home and drank a fifth of something and hoped it was all a bad dream, but he made it through. So.
Okay. Why on different parts? So that would be the seasons, I guess. Why on different parts of the planet? Warmer than others.
Same sort of thing. The systems, if everything's based on temperature, it's kind of like when people ask me about gravity. It's like, look, in an enclosed system, because an enclosed system is so much easier to maintain, you can make gravity any way you want, and you can make the temperature anywhere you want, anywhere. All you have to do is you make sure you sync it up with whatever's happening in the sky, because people automatically, it's like, well, if the sun's in this part of the sky, it's going to be a colder time of the year. You just got to make sure that's consistent and everything's pretty good at that point. But seasons, just temperature. That's a cakewalk. You don't have to try that hard for seasons.
Okay. What about the satellite tracking app?
No. I got you. What about it? You throw that in. Why don't you throw in the ISS tracking app or where our probes are in the solar system tracking app? And I know this is tough for people because no one wants to believe that science would ever lie to us. But you got to remember, NASA is not the Federation from Star Trek. Okay. NASA is a military. In fact, even the Federation from Star Trek was a military organization. NASA is a military organization. If they want to fake something, they're not going to tell you they're faking it. They're just going to fake it and hope that nobody notices. So yes, satellite tracking app is meaningless to me. Absolutely meaningless. And I refer you back to the space station. You know, I like to turn the arguments this way. It's like, why in the world are you pretending to have people on the space station? Why would you do that? There's only one reason why you would do that, and that is you can't. You have to do it. There's no way else up there, but you have to keep the illusion alive. They've kept it alive now for 50-something years. And they're going to keep, you know, as far as I know, they're not going to have a big disclosure thing. It's probably going to come out on its own, or you're going to have a whistleblower. But the short answer to this person's question is, if the ISS is faked, and it is, absolutely look, then everything else is in question. I doubt everything above commercial airliners.
Just another piece of trivia that I thought of, though, and it's worth mentioning, is that with all of the spacewalks, with all of the cameras that we've had out there, astronauts playing around, filming each other, whatever they're doing.
Yeah.
Even apparently statistically, it would have happened now by accident. But no one has panned out or done a 360.
Or done a 180. Oh, yeah. And I know we're running out of time, but I want to get into this for a second. There's a video out there, and I put it in my like section. It's by Max Malone. The bulk is from Max Malone, but it's called the same one. The final one is that one, Moon. And he catches the coolest things sometimes. And in his case, he said, look, there's 50 years of space footage. And no one, I'm going to try to do this without knocking off my headset. No one has taken the camera, just let it run, and turned around. Ever. No one's ever done that. On the moon, at the very least, you would have done this. No one has done a 180, and people say, well, you know, it's a camera technology thing. Well, no, it's not. It's a human thing. You're turning around, but you can't turn around if you're faking this, because if you're faking this, then you're faking all the moon missions were done on a studio. We've always suspected it for the longest time, you know, all the conspiracy people. And statistically speaking, someone would have accidentally turned around on accident. It's like, oh, what was that? You know, and turned around. They would have done that, but they never, ever did. And they can't, because even if they did, that footage would have been edited out. There is no live footage, as far as I know, anywhere. And you got to think, 50 years of footage, but nobody's done a 180. It's silly. It's ridiculous. Why wouldn't you do that? Even on accident, you would have done this by now, and they haven't.
We're down to a couple of minutes, and I know you know this gentleman, YouTuber Crow 777.
Is he on, or are you just going to mention him?
Just mentioning him. Someone's put him in the chat room here, that he has a video of the moon where. Yep. Looks, there's a ripple that goes over it.
Okay, yeah, I want to mention this.
But bearing in mind, we've got like 2.5 minutes.
Okay, I'll do it in one. Crow777, which I subscribe to his channel on YouTube. It's really the Crow777. He is not a flat earther, and what he did was took really nice close up HD movies of the moon, and he, you know, with really high end cameras, not the stuff you guys have, better cameras. And he was taking movies, and he saw a weird ripple go through the moon. And he thought it was his camera because it was brand new. He was calling the manufacturer, getting all upset. And he realized after a while that it wasn't the camera, that the ripple seemed to be some sort of refresh rate issue, you know, like a millisecond issue. You know, in the old days, it was like if you took a movie camera of a television screen, you'd get that weird vertical hold thing. It was like a millisecond. It was like it was out of phase with the camera tech. Basically, what he's saying is our camera technology is catching up with whatever projection system's involved here, because there are physical ripples that are going through the moon. The moon is the only place you would have seen this on. The stars, you wouldn't be able to catch it because it's too dark and you wouldn't be able to catch it. But the moon, there's these multiple waves that are going through the moon. And basically, he was saying, look, I don't know what the moon is, but there's something overlaid on the top of it. There is something visually, there is some sort of projection on top of the moon to where, you know, we're seeing what they want us to see. And it's brilliant. Check it out. You know, and he's not the only one that has seen it. You know, he put the call out. He's got a ton of subscribers. There's other people around the world that have seen it. And for me, it's just an indicator that this thing's kind of getting to the point where, again, like I mentioned, you can't keep this a secret forever. It's just too big. It's the whole world.
Okay. I know that certainly in this country, in Australia, there are indigenous stories about the time before the moon.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, yeah. When there was no moon.
When there was no moon.
Yeah.
Yes. And Australia's not alone on that one. There's some old stories from all over the world about the time before the moon.
Yeah.
So that's a whole other conversation.
Yeah, it is. It is. But if I might comment, it's a lot easier to do that in a flat model than it is a globe model. Because in a globe model, you'd actually have to station the moon on there. But in a flat model, you just put it up there. It's not hard at all. You just do it when no one's looking. And then turn it on one night and, you know, no one, since there's no cameras, nobody can prove one way or another that it happened. It just becomes myth. It's great.
And the tides and everything have... due to a different cause?
Tides are not affected by the moon. It can't be. Not if it's, even if it's a three-dimensional object, it's not big enough to do it. It's all controlled below, not necessarily by the temperature, but by some sort of gravity system using probably, molecular magnetism of some kind. Something easy. Something that could be done.
It's been awesome. Thank you so much. This is... you know, just the first of many interviews on this subject, I have a feeling, because the implications are just so huge.
Big.
And big. Big and flat, perhaps.
Big and flat.
I'd love to have you back in a couple of weeks.
I'd love to be back.
That'd be awesome.
Sure. Well,
thank you so much. And thanks to everybody in the chat room for letting us have this conversation and playing with us on this one. Do your research. Have some fun with it, because I think ultimately it's good news. It brings us back to us in a way that maybe nothing else really, really could. Well done. Thank you so much. See you very soon. And thanks to everybody for listening.